California. So Supervisor Chiu. Great, thank you. First of all, I want to thank all of you for being here tonight and thinking about how we're going to grow the future of San Francisco. I'm David Chiu. I've served for the last 6 years as the president of our San Francisco Board of Supervisors and really have helped to try to move our city forward from where we were 6 years ago when City Hall is much more dysfunctional than we would have liked. At a time when we had double-digit unemployment, massive budget deficits, and we weren't building any housing to a time today when we have been able to put tens of thousands of folks to work, we've been able to build more housing, we've been able to balance budgets. With regards to your question around food, let me start the following, which is I'm the first kid in my family born here in the United States. My mother is actually with us tonight. This is, I think, her second debate that she's been a part of. Thank you, Mom. And Mama kept a garden. And she made me when I was very young, but then as I grew older, I came to love growing things where we lived. And this is in part why it has been important for me to be the lead champion for the community of folks that you represent when it comes to urban gardening, when it comes to agricultural sustainability. Over the past 4 years, I have moved forward three laws. First in 2011 to streamline city bureaucracies to allow all of you to grow and sell the fruits of your labor. Secondly, to establish a citywide urban agriculture strategy for the city and to get that funded. And then just a few weeks ago, we became the first city in the state to establish urban agriculture incentive zones. Because at the end of the day, I'm passionate about believing that in the most dense neighborhoods on the West Coast here in San Francisco, we need to reclaim our open spaces. We need to reclaim that which is green, that which is healthy, that which is sustainable, that which is good for the environment. And I want to thank each and every one of you in your own ways, in every single neighborhood in the city, in being part of this movement, because San Francisco is a leader when it comes to urban agriculture, and I'd like to be a champion for you in Sacramento so we can continue to spread this throughout our state. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I want to thank all of you for being here, to WESA, the San Francisco Marin Food Bank, and to SF Urban Agriculture Alliance. And it's very special for me to be at the LGBT Center. But let me say this. We do have two people running for this seat. I think that there are two good people, but these are two good people who have a different vision for where we are in San Francisco and where we need to be in San Francisco, and that translates to the state of California. I believe that San Francisco right now is at a crossroads in its history. On one hand, we are the wealthiest city in the entire country, and yet we're also the city that has the fastest growing inequality in the entire country. If San Francisco were a separate, independent country, we would have inequality that rivals countries in Africa and Latin America. The prosperity that people are talking about, that David Chiu and others take credit for, is the prosperity that unfortunately has not benefited the vast majority of San Franciscans. And that is definitely manifesting itself when it comes to food security in San Francisco. The fact is that the haves are doing pretty well, but the have-nots are doing extremely poorly in San Francisco. And the numbers, if you can see by the number of tents of people sleeping on the street in different neighborhoods, and that translates into people who are not able to eat. And I believe that what we need is a change of course, a refocus on regular people, working people in San Francisco, and we need someone who's going to be a champion for those people in the state of California. I think it is shameful that the state of California is spending $1 million in terms of trying to feed hungry people in California when we know that the need is far greater than that. And when I go to Sacramento, I will make that a top priority because I think it's shameful that in the richest state, in the richest country in the world, people still go hungry every single day.
To me as the Chronicle candidate. I have also been endorsed by the African American Sun Reporter, by the Chinese Tsingtao newspaper, as well as by the LGBT Bay Area Reporter. Let me just read. It's one thing to fight for an issue by holding press conferences and speaking at rallies. It's another thing to actually come up with a plan and see it through to becoming policy by passing an ordinance. That's the difference between Chiu and his opponent, and why at the end of the day, the LGBT Bay Area Reporter recommends.
It's not rocket science. They either pay the tax that they owe, they don't, and your law. struggle because there is not a single business in San Francisco that is allowed to open its doors without even paying back a license fee, let alone $28 million in back taxes. That is just sort of like, we're not talking about that. It's simple, David. They either pay or they don't. So I understand there's a lot of important issues confronting the city and county of San Francisco, confronting District 17, and confronting the state of California, but we're going to try to keep it as much as possible focused on the issues that are really important to the sponsors of tonight's event, including this next one from Cueto. And I believe I'm keeping the order more or less right. This should begin with Supervisor Campos. In 2014, the legislature considered but did not pass Assembly Bill 2385, which would have supported Market Match, and that's a nutrition incentive program that matches customers' federal nutrition assistance benefits like CalFresh, aka food stamps, at farmers markets. Market Match increases low-income shoppers' capacity to purchase fresh fruits and vegetables, and it brings revenue to local markets. Would you support this kind of Market Match program if the bill came before the Assembly again? If so, please tell us how you would secure long-term funding for the program. And if you don't support the Market Match program, please explain why.
Well, I would support the program and more than support it. I look forward to being a champion of that program and working with these organizations to make sure that we get it passed this time around. Let me say this, that this issue of what's available to low-income communities is something that's very personal and very important to me. I came to this country at the age of 14 undocumented. My family, my two sisters, my parents and I, we lived in South Central LA. And I can tell you that for almost a year and a half, the only way that we could actually have food on the table was to go to the local food banks that were serving food in South Central Los Angeles. My parents worked and they tried to work as hard as they could, but they simply could not make enough money to put food on that table. And I know that whatever food we had was because they were able to do that and rely on that service. And I appreciate the fact that at the church that we went to, that the priest that was there made a point of making sure that kids like me had access to vegetables, which unfortunately is not the way life works for a lot of kids in South Central LA. I want to make sure that a kid doesn't go through what I had to go through when I was growing up in South Central LA. This is not just about food, this is about justice. And we cannot have justice in the wealthiest state, in the wealthiest country, unless actually those who have the greatest need have decent food available to them. So not only will I support it, you have my commitment that I'm going to be a champion for it when I'm elected.
Part of what we know of as a bit of a food desert, where they don't have access to healthy and fresh foods. And we've had a lot of conversations about how we would move this forward, and this is why I'm proud to have the support of the district supervisor who represents the Bayview, as well as her predecessor, because they know I've been committed to this, they know I've worked with them to try to bring better options to that area. At the end of the day, though, and one, I absolutely support AB 2385, and I'm happy to champion that with Assemblymember Phil Ting, who has been working on that issue. We obviously need more dollars to go into these systems, and I am the one candidate here who has been able to move forward getting corporations to pay more tax dollars. We have, because of the work that I did in 2012, we moved from a tax on workers' salaries to now a tax on corporate profits. We're bringing in $300 million in extra in revenues to our city to move these forward in all sorts of areas to really bolster our social safety net. Let me say, though, one thing when it comes to the state level, where I would go to look for revenues. California is the only major oil-producing state in the country that does not tax oil. And I want to tax oil. We need and can get billions of dollars if we were to levy a tax on oil, and this is money on oil, and this is money that could go to our schools, money that could go to fixed muni, money that could go to affordable housing, and money that could go to addressing food deserts.
just put in $350,000 in an independent expenditure campaign on behalf of David Chiu. $350,000, you know, $28 million is actually a pretty good return on their investment. Education. I actually think that we have the opportunity to address this need of making sure that we have in the future generations farmers. And I think that we need to create a program so that in places like San Francisco, like the San Francisco Unified School District, you actually have kids who are exposed to that being a possibility for them. I believe that there are many kids who don't even know that, perhaps have never even, you know, seen what it takes to grow something. And I know that some schools are changing that, but I think that we need to do that, and I think that we need to start at the K to 12 level very early on. Because what's happening right now is that you have kids, many of them, by the way, who come from cultures where there is a very strong connection to the land, that in this city don't have that connection. And not only are they not having that connection, but in some respects, they're losing an important side, a part of who they are in terms of their culture. I think that our school system needs to invest in those kinds of programs, and I think that we need to do so and connect it not only with the elementary schools, but the middle schools and the high schools. And quite frankly, I also think that it's an issue of resources, because I don't believe that we're going to be able to do that on the scale that needs to be done in San Francisco or in the state of California unless our public school system is better funded and actually makes an investment in that kind of program.
So I think it's a great question. I think it's easy also to talk about what you want to do. Let me talk about what I've already done. San Francisco, we are now the first city in the state to have established urban agriculture incentive zones. What this means is that if you find a vacant or blighted corner, any part of the city, and the owner is not sure what to do with it, and you approach that owner and they agree for 5 years to put that land, whether it be half an acre or a couple of acres, to use as an urban garden, we actually have incentives to do this. And now what we have done here in San Francisco, because of the leadership of this community, this is a model that is being looked at all around the state. That was the legislation that I carried. And this is what you asked a question around the fact that a lot of farmers are aging. And I think one of the things that is remarkable about our local urban agriculture community is it is young. The future is bright. Many of you are absolutely committed and view this as not just something you want to do on the weekends, but it is something you want to think about as an occupation. And I think it's important for us to support this as a community. And let me also say one other thing, which is the reason many of our city's minimum wage workers are supporting me, whether they be janitors or security guards or the United Food and Commercial Workers that work at Safeway and work in our supermarkets, they know that I have been fighting for more dollars for workforce development, which is more training to give them the skills that they need so that someday they're not just checking the fruit and groceries at a Safeway, but they're actually running their own business, hopefully in an agricultural setting.
Well, I think that we agree generally in terms of policy, but I actually, it's not correct to imply that somehow the working people of San Francisco are supporting David Chiu and not David Campos. To the contrary, I think that the reason why so many workers are getting behind my campaign is because they know that right now, in the midst of this so-called prosperity that David keeps talking about, most of these working people are being left behind. And the reality is that there's only one campaign that is going to fight for those people, and that's my campaign.
And even some food producers have expressed concerns. In an op-ed published Friday in the San Jose Mercury News, Bay Area fishmonger Paul Johnson of Monterey Fish Market, who had a great distribution in the Ferry Building, or on the pier, warned that Proposition 1 will harm California salmon and crab fisheries. So I guess my question to you is, if Jane Voter comes with you on the street and says, should I vote for Prop 1, what do you say, and why or why not? I think we're combo town.
Well, I guess I would say that I need to learn a little bit more, given some of the concerns that have been raised by the environmentalist groups that you discussed. I do generally believe in supporting increased infrastructure. I do think, though, that there has to be a balance in terms of who pays for that infrastructure, and I think generally we should be guided by the principle that if we're going to build infrastructure that benefits a geographic area in the state, that geographic area should actually bear more of the brunt of the financial.
California has a lot of leverage in Sacramento is because we do have a lot of water relative to the rest of the state. And I want to make sure that whatever we do when it comes to this route, that we don't do anything to harm Hetch Hetchy and the need that is clearly here in San Francisco. I also think that it's not just about building infrastructure, though. I think that we need to have smart policies, including recycling. I think that we're doing a good job in San Francisco when it comes to water conservation, but we're not recycling our water, and I think that we need to do that. That's the kind of policy that I want to bring, approach that I want to bring to the state. But I am proud that when those issues come up, that I'm going to be working with the League of Conservation Voters, with the Sierra Club. I am the only candidate that has had the support of both organizations, and I think there's a reason for that, because they know that you can trust me as a steward for not only the right policies, but also protection of the environment.
So I think it's important to take a stand on these issues, and I do support the water bond. I think there are many things that are good about it around water efficiency, water recycling, water storage, safe drinking water. That being said, we need to be watchful to make sure that these monies are not automatically used, and I think there are enough protections on this for building new water infrastructure. I do agree with David that the so-called twin tunnel program, I think, is something that we really need to be cautious before moving forward. We need to think about water conservation first before we build enormous water infrastructure that will allow huge amounts of water to flow from north down to south. Now, this is an area I have already done work on here in San Francisco. I helped to establish a program in our city to create incentives for water to be recycled within major buildings. This is an innovative program. If you go to our PUC building on Golden Gateway, that is a building that's using 60% less water, recycling 5,000 gallons a day of wastewater, storing 25,000 gallons of rainwater in the basement. I've also moved forward legislation to streamline the permitting process to set up systems to help treat water, and I passed first in the country legislation to phase out plastic water bottles on public properties in San Francisco and require the installation of drink taps. We need to do better with the water we have. I took on the $60 billion water bottle industry. I appreciate, David, your support on this, but this is also why the California League of Conservation Voter has supported my candidacy.
This is a smart question, I thought, from Michael Dimmick in the audience. Have you been to the Central Valley or coastal farm communities of, say, San Mateo County and Santa Cruz County, and to hear their views on food and agriculture issues? I think the first response goes to you.
Yes, and in fact, I have. And one of the things that has been very eye-opening experience for me is learning about the rest of the state. And the reality is that no resolution is going to happen unless we actually sit down with people from different parts of the state, including people from the Central Valley who are in this business of agriculture. But one thing that I would say is that what I am proud of when it comes to my campaign is that I have, I think, the widest level of support from members of the state legislature. There's a reason why I have more members of the state legislature that are supporting my candidacy than they are supporting David Chiu, because they know that I actually bring a statewide perspective when it comes to these issues. I am from San Francisco. I'm proud to be a San Franciscan, but I also grew up in Southern California, and I know some of the challenges that other parts of the state bring to the table. I think it's that level of understanding and being able to connect with people that will make sure that I'm effective in bringing these people in Sacramento together on a resolution.
Supervisor Chiu? So I have visited those parts of the state a couple of years ago when I was an immigrant rights attorney, representing undocumented immigrants who had been discriminated against in all sorts of ways. And in fact, on a statewide lawsuit where immigrants were being evicted out of their homes simply because of their immigration status, and had numerous conversations about the plight that they faced, both as immigrants as well as agricultural workers.
This is a question from Daniel Boulay. He says, what policies are the most promising to address food access and food insecurity issues in San Francisco in terms of preventative measures or proactive ones versus
of my record over the last 4 years of helping to create 70,000 jobs here in San Francisco, ensuring that many of our lowest wage workers who have who are still challenged in our expensive city, but many of whom now have jobs at a time when we have 4% unemployment, that is, I think, fundamental to making sure that folks don't go hungry.
We have an affordability crisis that has actually made food security a major problem for so many people. The reason why so many people are struggling to put food on the table in San Francisco is because so much of their money is going to actually put a roof over their head. And that's why, for me, this issue of affordability goes to the heart of what's happening to San Francisco. We need to make sure that San Francisco is affordable for working class, middle-income people, heck, even upper middle-income people. That's why I have worked not only on housing being more affordable, but also on programs like free muni for low-income and middle-income youth, so that families don't have to choose between paying for a bus fare on a given day or actually buying food for their kids. We need to make sure that San Francisco and California are affordable. Unless we do that, food insecurity will remain a problem.
So I think it's easy to talk about what we need to do to address our housing affordability crisis. It's one thing to talk about it. It's another thing to actually work on it. And my record, by the way, I am the tenant in this race. I moved forward about a dozen policies to build more affordable housing for homeless veterans, for homeless foster youth, for seniors, and for families. I didn't vote against 20,000 units of new housing that would have built more public housing, more low-income affordable housing. And I have a record of actually delivering in this area. David Campos didn't do a single thing when it came to our housing crisis until this year, which is the year that we started campaigning.
And you've got a chance for rebuttal. Well, that's just not believable, David. There's a reason why the people who have done this work, people in the San Francisco Affordable Housing Coalition and the San Francisco Tenants Union that represents thousands of tenants in San Francisco, have given me their sole endorsement, because they know that it's more than just talk. It's about actually fighting, taking on the big developers, even though it means that you're not going to get the kind of funding that your campaign is getting, but it's actually about fighting to keep San Francisco. Today, I went to court because our relocation cost was sued, that law was sued by the tenants, by the landlords, who are trying to keep tenants from actually having enough money to be able to relocate in San Francisco.
And the microphone is still yours, since we're now going to question four here. This is from Bob Drake, and this is kind of good news. This is going to be our last audience question of the night, and they'll each have a chance for a final statement. And Bob Drake wants to know, and he points out that new techniques in oil and gas drilling have led to tensions among fossil fuel interests and food producers. Will you support a total ban on fracking to protect water quality and quantity of Californians for agriculture?
Absolutely. Let me say that I want to be careful about using the term ban, because ban implies that at some point maybe things could change and you could allow it to happen. I don't think that we are at a point that fracking should even be an option, because I don't think that the science has really proven that something like this is even safe. So I am proud to go to the state legislature and fight against fracking. And I think that San Francisco needs to lead the way on this issue. And I think that one of the reasons that the Sierra Club has endorsed me is because they know that I'm passionate about this issue. Because I know that in the end, when the person goes to Sacramento, they're going to have a lot of pressure from these money interests to actually go against the promises they made. My record is clear. I'm not afraid to stand up to the special interests.
Supervisor Chiu, to Bob Drake's question.
I think it's a great question from Bob, and let me say the following, which again, it's easy to talk, but I have already led the way here in San Francisco on the topic of fracking. We passed a resolution earlier this year putting San Francisco as the sixth jurisdiction in the state of California to say we need to have a moratorium on fracking. And I authored that legislation. I worked with environmental advocates, with hundreds of community-based organizations and environmental groups around the state to move this movement, and the leadership needs to come from San Francisco. I have already led on this, and I'm one of the elected officials that is a signatory on a statewide letter that has gone to Governor Jerry Brown asking him to not move forward with fracking.
Let's take that resolution. solution because a number of us, myself included, told them that it wasn't strong enough because the way that it was originally drafted, it left open the possibility that fracking could actually happen. I'm glad that he finally listened to us and recognized that it's one of those issues where there should be no room for error. It should be banned and we should not allow it, period.
They disagree with that characterization. It was my resolution. I drafted it. We drafted it with environmentalists. No one, we didn't have issues when we were moving forward, and a couple of folks after the fact, a couple of organizations wanted us to change a few words, which I was happy to do. Again, it was my leadership. I championed that resolution. He likes to talk about what he wants to do. I'm actually delivering results on behalf of San Francisco.
Well, thank you both, gentlemen, for fielding those freewheeling audience questions. We're now going to close, and thank you again to the audience for coming up with them. We're going to close a closing statement.
The action is not about just who is going to represent San Francisco in the 17th Assembly District. In many respects, this election is about the future of the city. I believe that we're actually fighting for the soul of San Francisco. We are fighting for the soul of San Francisco because right now we are a city that on one hand is the wealthiest in the country and yet is leaving behind most San Franciscans. If you are happy with the status quo, if you believe that it's okay that San Francisco has the highest inequality of any major city in this country, then you should vote for David Chiu. But if you believe that San Francisco should be a place where working people, middle-income people, have a place to call home, then I ask you to consider my candidacy. The reason why, even though they have three times the amount of money that we have, we are winning this election is because people know that San Francisco is headed in the wrong direction. San Francisco cannot be San Francisco unless working class and middle-income people who built the city get to live here. The reason why all these corporate interests are spending more money on David Chiu's campaign than in any other campaign in the state of California is because they know that when I get to Sacramento, they have to do something that they have never done. Play by the same rules that you and I play by every single day. Let's take our city back. Vote David Campos, November 4th.
I do understand that as of, I think, today's filing period, David Campos and his allies have over $1 million. Again, from real estate developers, from corporations, from some of the wealthiest interests in our state. He is the newest millionaire representing the Mission District. And he is trying to destroy. He is trying, with his allies, to lie about my record and conflate facts. And let me just throw out a few facts. David Campos and David Chiu, we voted together 98% of the time. I passed 105 ordinances while he has passed 37. I passed a half a dozen first in the country pieces of environmental legislation that have been modeled now around the country. And for the urban agriculture community, I've worked many, many months to move forward an urban agriculture agenda with three policies here. And let me quote the San Francisco Chronicle from a week and a half ago. The battle of two supervisors named David has been one of the fiercest legislative fights in the state, even though their policy differences are relatively minor in the context of California politics. Each would be a strong progressive Democrat in the state capitol. We endorsed David Chiu, a proven consensus builder at City Hall, on the belief that he would be more effective. Everything about the harshly divisive David Campos campaign